Audible Inc. presents When Can You Trust the Experts? How to Tell Good Science from Bad in Education. Written by Daniel T. Willingham. Narrated by Daniel T. Willingham.
Introduction. What are you to believe? Try this sometime. Ask a friend, why do you believe what you believe? What sort of evidence persuades you that someone's right or that a product is good? This question seldom elicits a careful, thoughtful response. Rather, it elicits silence and narrowed eyes. Most people think that their beliefs are shaped by logic and reason. Your friend will likely detect a whiff of insult in the question. But our beliefs are fueled by much more than reason and fact. Yes, we're persuaded by solid evidence assembled into arguments that conform to principles of logic, but that's true only for the messages that we examine, and we don't have time to audit every advertisement we hear and blog posting we read. We're pelted by information almost constantly. Just think of the ubiquity of screens, at airport gates and restaurants and waiting rooms and the post office, even in hotel elevators. If a location provides a captive human audience, there's likely to be a screen flashing updates from Afghanistan, coverage of a golf tournament, or an advertisement for Claritin. Much of this information is not neutral. It's meant to persuade us of something, yet we don't have the time or the mental energy to think through every message that comes our way. Are we influenced by messages that we ignore? I stand in line in my bank, and I notice a large television screen behind the teller displaying a channel exclusive to my bank. An advertisement appears showing a sedan wending along a New England country road, scattering autumn leaves. I go into a reverie, thinking of the Berkshire Mountains. I haven't consciously noticed the make of the car, but am I nevertheless influenced? When I next need a car, even if it's 4 years from now, perhaps I'll be a bit more likely to buy this model because I was exposed to this ad. Will I be more likely to apply for a car loan at this bank rather than shopping around for the best rate? Is it possible for attitudes to change outside of my awareness? Although it makes us uncomfortable to contemplate it, psychological research from the last 50 years indicates that the answer is yes. Sometimes, of course, I do pay attention to these messages, and I don't fully trust what I'm hearing. For example, when I read Mother Jones or the Weekly Standard, I'm aware that each has a political point of view, and I try to remember that information may be omitted or the interpretation of facts stretched to be consistent with that point of view. When I hear the president of Iran give a speech, I recall that he's denied that the Holocaust took place, so I'm wary of any claim that he makes. When I listen carefully to messages, am I able to account for the bias or trustworthiness of the source? To some extent, yes, but not completely. I'm making it sound as though we're all buffeted about. No, worse, systematically manipulated by forces that operate outside our awareness, or, even if we are aware of them, outside our control. Putting it that way is a bit dramatic, but it's not far from the truth. This book will show you how to evaluate new ideas, in particular those related to education, so that you're less likely to be persuaded by bad evidence. The Golden Ratio. Forewarned is forearmed. The first step in defending yourself from hidden persuaders is identifying them. I begin with what is perhaps the strangest example. The very shape that carries information to you has an impact on whether or not you believe this information. This story is a bit complex, although the mathematics behind it is relatively simple. You and I have a number in common, a number that influences what we consider beautiful and worthy of our sustained attention. 1.618. Actually, it's 1.618033988, but I'll use the truncated version. It's important not as a number, but as a ratio, and the simplest way to understand it is to imagine a rectangle and think of the ratio of the height and the width of the rectangle. If that ratio is 1.618, people will find it more aesthetically pleasing than other rectangles. Confronted with, say, 30 rectangles of various proportions, most people will pick this one as the most attractive. Because of its importance in aesthetics, 1.618 is called the golden ratio. Researchers have observed this ratio in classical architecture. For example, the width and height of the facade of the Parthenon in Greece respects the golden ratio. It's also observed in the Great Pyramid of Giza. If one forms a triangle using the length of one face of the pyramid and half of the length of the base, it's within 1% of the golden ratio. The golden ratio is observed in smaller scale works of art as well, including the placement of figures and paintings by Da Vinci and the elements of the Stradivarius violin. Why would this ratio be aesthetically pleasing across cultures and across centuries? A reasonable suggestion is that it's commonly observed in nature. Indeed, the golden ratio is found in proportions of the human body and the human face, especially faces that others find attractive. If the distance between the navel and the foot is taken as one unit, the height of a human being is typically equivalent to 1.618. Some other golden proportions in the average human body are the distance between the fingertip and the elbow, and the distance between the wrist and the elbow, the distance between the shoulder line and the top of the head, and the head length, the distance between the navel and the top of the head, and the distance between the shoulder line and the top of the head. Naturally, there's variation across individuals in these proportions. The golden ratio is observed when we take averages across many individuals, and individuals with the ideal proportions are judged by others as having well-proportioned bodies. The same is true for faces, and here the relationship to attractiveness is easy to appreciate. Faces are attractive not only because the eyes and mouth are well-shaped. The proportions of the face must be right. If a person's eyes are too close together or too far apart, he or she is not attractive. The actress Jessica Alba, commonly considered to be very attractive, not only has a dazzling smile and beautiful eyes, but the distances between her features match the golden ratio perfectly. The golden ratio is observed elsewhere in nature as a spiral. To understand how, you need a basic understanding of the underlying mathematics. The golden ratio was first described by the 12th century mathematician Leonardo Fibonacci. Perhaps you've heard of the Fibonacci sequence. I begin with the numbers 0 and 1, and then add the last two numbers in the sequence to generate the next number. That is, 0 plus 1 equals 1, so the sequence begins 0, 1, 1. To obtain the next number, I add the final two in the sequence thus far, hence 1 plus 1 equals 2, so now the sequence is 0, 1, 1, 2. Continuing, the sequence is 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, and so on. If I take the ratio of successive numbers in the Fibonacci sequence, those values converge on the golden ratio. Now suppose that I create squares, each with sides equivalent to the numbers in the Fibonacci sequence. That is, I create squares whose sides are length 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, and so on. Each square I create is added to the others so that they form a rectangle. Then I can create an arc by connecting opposite corners of the squares. This is called a Fibonacci arc, and it too is observed in nature, for example, in the shape of seashells like the nautilus, and in the pattern of the seeds of flowers, such as the sunflower and the daisy. Spirals are observed in other plants too, for example, the cauliflower. Fibonacci sequences are also present, though more subtly so, in the arrangement of the leaves of many plants. So imagine a plant with a central stalk, with leaves growing out of it. If I start with the top leaf, we would need three clockwise rotations before we meet another leaf directly below the first, and would pass five leaves on the way. If we go counterclockwise, we need just two rotations. Note that 2, 3, and 5 are consecutive Fibonacci numbers. This ratio of rotations to leaves is commonly observed. The interpretation of the aesthetic value of the golden ratio would seem to be clear. We are naturally drawn to objects showing the golden ratio because this ratio is found throughout nature. But what's the connection of the golden ratio to persuasion? The great 19th century British poet John Keats ended Ode on a Grecian Urn with these words, "Beauty is truth, truth beauty. That is all you know on earth and all you need to know." Keats, as it turns out, was an excellent psychologist. We associate beauty and truth. When we see something that's physically beautiful, we assume that it has other good qualities, including truthfulness. In semiotics, the study of symbols, one would call this a sign. Just as red means hot and blue means cold, beauty means truth. But the significance of red and blue to temperature is a cultural convention and one that each of us must learn. The connection of beauty and truth is made across cultures and need not be learned. It seems to be a natural part of the human makeup. People are more likely to believe the contents of a book or magazine if its dimensions correspond to the golden ratio. Children's books might be square, and so might art or cookbooks, but something like 95% of nonfiction books that seek to persuade are sold in dimensions within 2% of the golden ratio. The figure for magazines is over 90%. The golden ratio does exert a powerful and powerfully subtle influence on persuasion, or it would, if not for one small problem. The golden ratio theory is bunk. Some of the statistics I've cited here are just plain inaccuracies. Studies have been conducted in which people, ordinary people, or professional artists and designers, are shown a large selection of rectangles and are asked which they find the most attractive. It's not the case that people select the golden ratio rectangles. Another study examined the dimensions of 565 rectangular paintings by famous artists. Artists showed no predilection for canvas sizes that respected the golden ratio. The mean ratio was 1.34. And natural objects like the human body, faces, seashells, they show a lot of variability. It's not the case that the most attractive show the golden ratio. The statistics about the dimensions of books and magazines are complete fabrications. Some of the golden ratio phenomena are accurate, but trivial. Trivial because examples that fit the golden ratio are emphasized, and examples that do not fit are ignored. Why evaluate the Parthenon, but not the Pantheon? Why the Pyramid of Giza, but not the Pyramid of Khafre? For that matter, why not the Roman Colosseum, the Taj Mahal, the Alhambra, or the Eiffel Tower? Then, too, a complex figure like the Parthenon, or the Last Supper, has many measurable features. That makes it too easy to pick and choose measurements that yield the desired ratio. I apologize for beginning this book with a sucker punch. Maybe some part of me wanted company. I fell for the golden ratio hook, line, and sinker when I first heard it. Golden ratio is interesting not because it's true. It's interesting because the idea survives and continues to attract believers, even though it's known to be wrong. In that way, it's an object lesson for this book. Knowing what to believe is a problem. The problem. People believe lots of things for which the scientific evidence is absent. That a special coin brings them luck, that aliens visit the Earth regularly, astrological predictions are better than chance. Many such beliefs, though unfounded, are harmless. Maybe they cost us a little time or money, but we find them fun or interesting. We don't take them all that seriously anyway. Author's note: if you believe any of these things, please don't be insulted by my cavalier dismissal. I'm not here to tell you what to believe, but I will state flatly that there's no scientific evidence supporting these beliefs. Unfounded beliefs related to schooling are of greater concern. The costs in time and money can be substantial. Worse, faulty beliefs about learning can potentially cost kids their education. Scientific tools can be a real help in sorting out which methods and materials truly help students learn and which do not. We cannot afford to let educational practice be guided by hunch or hope if better information is available. But even though scientific tools are routinely applied, the product is often ignored, or else it's twisted by people with dollars on their minds. Consider learning styles theories. These theories maintain that different people have different ways of learning, and that we can identify an individual style, tune our teaching to that style, and make learning easier or more effective. For example, the most popular theory of learning style holds that some people learn best by seeing things, visual learners, some by hearing things, auditory learners, and some by manipulating objects, kinesthetic learners. This theory has been around for at least 25 years, and it's been tested in scientific experiments. In fact, testing the theory is quite straightforward. First, take 100 people and identify them as visual or auditory learners. Let's skip kinesthetic learners for the sake of simplicity. Second, devise comparable visual and auditory materials to learn. For example, people might listen to a story, auditory, or watch a silent slideshow depicting the same story, visual. Third, have 50 people experience the story in their preferred way, and 50 people experience the story in their non-preferred way. Fourth, the next day, test everyone's memory for the story. If the learning styles theory is true, people who experience the story in their preferred way ought to remember it better. Experiments like this have been conducted, and there's no support for the learning styles idea. Not for visual, auditory, or kinesthetic learners, not for linear or holistic learners, nor for any of the other learners described by learning styles theories. Yet if you search for learning styles on the internet, you will not find a brief academic obituary for this interesting idea that turned out to be wrong. You'll find almost 2 million hits. You'll find almost 2,000 books on Amazon. You'll find the term mentioned on the syllabi of thousands of college courses. And you'll find lots and lots of products that promise improved educational outcome once you know students' learning styles. Although knowing students' learning style often requires buying the book they want to sell you or attending the workshop they're conducting. The main cost of learning styles seems to be wasted time and money, and some worry on the part of teachers who feel that they ought to be paying more attention to learning styles, for it appears that most teachers don't do that much with them. The cost of other scientifically inaccurate beliefs has been much more substantial. Consider this example. Before about 1920, the way to teach children to read seemed obvious. You start by teaching them the sound associated with each letter or letter combination. In the first quarter of the 20th century, another theory of reading rose to prominence. In essence, it argued that children should be taught to read the way adults read. Adults seem to read entire words or even phrases all at once. Watch the eyes of someone reading and you'll see they don't dwell on each and every word, but rather stop several times as they scan each line. Adults read silently, which is much faster than reading aloud. And adults read what interests them. Children, in contrast, are taught to read sound by sound, not whole words. They read aloud, not silently. And they read out of boring primers, not engaging material. In what became known as the look-say or whole-word method, children were encouraged to memorize entire words. Books for reading instruction used a limited set of words so as to make memorization possible. Students were encouraged to guess at a word based on the surrounding context and pictures if they didn't recognize it. This method also emphasized that phonics drills, memorizing letters and their associated sounds, are boring, and that using them was likely to make children hate reading. Instead, the whole word method suggested that children be surrounded by real books, not drill materials, and that stories be ones that they can understand and identify with. The whole word method became dominant in American education during the 1930s and 1940s. Two factors might have tipped off educators that this approach to reading instruction was suspect. First, written language is a sound-based system, not a meaning-based system. Seeing the three letters D, O, and G doesn't tell you meaning. Letters signify sounds. If that weren't true, then when I showed you an unfamiliar word, for example, molesta, you wouldn't just be uncertain of its meaning. You would also have no idea of how to pronounce it. Given that writing is sound-based, teaching reading with a method that ignores sound seems risky. Second, the theory encourages the teaching of reading based on the way adults read. On the one hand, you can see the logic. If you want to learn something, find someone who's good at it and then try to do what he or she does. On the other hand, there's no guarantee that the expert did it that way when he or she was a beginner. An expert basketball player no longer needs to think about the basics of ball handling and footwork because that has been so extensively practiced. The expert thinks about playmaking and strategy, but the beginner needs to think about the fundamentals. Copying an expert reader is not necessarily a good strategy for beginning readers. In 1955, the book Why Can't Johnny Read was published. It argued that if the direct teaching of the sounds that go with letters were omitted, reading was not being taught. The book was a strident take-no-prisoners invective, and it became a bestseller. The book was negatively reviewed by many education professionals, however. Professors who studied reading argued that the book was ill-informed and that the author was simply wrong. Over the next several years, arguments over how to teach reading raged, later dubbed the Reading Wars. In 1961, the Carnegie Corporation sought a scholar to comb through all the scientific studies and to draw a conclusion. Was phonics-based or whole-word instruction superior? Jean Chaul, a professor at the Harvard Graduate School of Education, was selected to conduct the review. In her 1967 book, she said that the relevant research showed that the phonics method was superior. That sounds clear enough, right? Education rides off the rails briefly, well, actually for 30 years or so, but science comes to the rescue. So we would expect that post-1967, the whole word approach to reading instruction would be relegated to the dustbin. Well, we'd be wrong. The basic idea behind whole word reading resurfaced in the mid-1980s. Renamed whole language, the pitch was familiar. Phonics instruction deadens interest and is unnecessary. Learning to read is as natural as learning to speak, Just surround kids with authentic materials and they will learn to read on their own. The reading wars began again. Some districts and even entire states, notably California, adopted curricula based on the whole language method of teaching reading. In 1997, Congress asked the Department of Education to draw together a panel of reading experts to sort through the scientific research on reading instruction. Their conclusion, published in 2000, matched that of Chaff in 1967. Phonics instruction is a critical part of learning to read. In its absence, some kids figure out on their own the sounds that go with letters and letter combinations, but some don't. And those kids will end up disliking reading, and some of them will end up being labeled as dyslexic. The first phase of the reading wars was understandable. Somebody had an ill-conceived theory about reading instruction. It sounded good, so people tried it. It's somewhat more difficult to understand why it took as long as it did, some 30 years, for the scientific evidence to influence public opinion and public policy. It's nearly inconceivable that the same mistake was made again 20 years later, sparking the second phase of the reading wars. When science is brought to bear on education problems carelessly or underhandedly, perhaps the worst damage is inflicted on kids with disabilities. As the parent of a child with Edwards syndrome, also called trisomy 18, I have personal experience here. Many developmental disabilities do not have effective treatments, and parents are desperate. They're willing, even eager, to try unproven alternative treatments, anything that might work, anything that holds out some hope. Furthermore, there are a lot of disabled kids in this country. Estimates are that about 13% of kids have some disability, ranging from very mild speech impairments to chromosome disorders that affect nearly every aspect of intellectual and physical development. Scam artists go where the money is, and the parents of kids with autism spectrum disorder, ASD, are some of their preferred targets because there are a lot of them. Kids with ASD show a fairly broad range of characteristic behaviors, but they tend to have these in common. First, difficulty with communication, both verbal and nonverbal, that is, pointing and gesturing. Second, problems in social relations, especially in perceiving the emotions and thinking of others. And third, repetitive behaviors, such as following a strict routine or repeating words or actions again and again. Rates of autism have skyrocketed since 1994, probably due to changes in diagnostic criteria, so that now approximately 1 in 110 American kids is diagnosed. Treatment options are limited. The most reliable are behavioral therapies. These boil down to trying to teach the child which behavior is appropriate in a given situation. For example, to make eye contact and to respond when a cashier says thank you. If he knows which behavior is appropriate but usually doesn't do it, the focus is on increasing the frequency with which the child does it. Behavioral therapy for ASD is frustrating for everyone involved. It's slow, it's painstaking, and it must feel to parents like a band-aid. It doesn't address the underlying problem, just the symptoms. The underlying problem is certainly not behavioral. Kids don't have ASD because of something their parents did or didn't do. ASD has a biological basis. So it seems that the treatment ought to be biological. Hucksters offer a wide range of dubious biological therapies for ASD, none of them approved by the Food and Drug Administration, and all of them seeming to offer the promise of getting at the root cause. The least expensive and safest, but certainly inconvenient to follow, include vitamins and supplements or special diets. Other therapies can be wildly expensive, for example, hyperbaric oxygen therapy. Here the child is put in a sealed environment of enriched oxygen at a pressure greater than atmospheric pressure, which helps the blood carry more oxygen to the organs. Treatments might cost several thousand dollars each month. Another unproven ASD treatment is immunoglobulin, antibodies approved for leukemia and AIDS, which runs about $10,000. Much worse than the costs are the potential side effects. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy can put stress on the lungs, the heart, and other organs. Immunoglobulin can cause fever, headaches, meningitis, even anaphylactic shock. What are these parents thinking? Why would they subject their children to unproven therapies? As is so often the case, treatments that initially sound bizarre do have a certain logic once you scratch a bit beneath the surface. There are data showing evidence of inflammation in the brains of autistic children. These data come from a study published in a prestigious scientific journal, Annals of Neurology, by a research team at Johns Hopkins University. The claimed benefit of hyperbaric oxygen therapy and of immunoglobulin is the reduction of inflammation. So there is a rationale for the treatment. If you were a parent listening to someone trying to sell you one of these treatments, the odds are good that you would be told about the study showing inflammation in the brain of kids with ASD. What you would not be told is that the researchers anticipated that quacks would rush in to use their research as the basis for ASD, quote, remedies. So on their website, they published a plain language explanation of the findings, along with a strongly worded warning against using these findings. Quote, there is no indication for using anti-inflammatory medications in patients with autism, close quote. The website mentions immunoglobulin in particular as unlikely to have a significant effect because of the mechanism by which it reduces inflammation. When we read about fringe ASD treatments, there's a strong temptation to think, I'm no sucker. I wouldn't believe something for which there's no evidence. Other parents, teachers, and administrators aren't stupid either. As I note, the treatments they believe will work do have a certain logic behind them. Whole language advocates were correct in criticizing many phonics drills as boring, and the idea of following the methods used by more expert readers has a surface plausibility. The purveyors of unproven ASD therapies can point to reputable scientific studies as their backing, and it would take some scientific sophistication to know that the studies were being misinterpreted. Digging deep enough to spot the misinterpretation may be tougher than you'd think. Why the obvious solution doesn't work. Suppose you're a parent looking for supplementary support for your child with dyslexia, or a teacher curious about your district's plan to put a new math program in place, or an educational administrator who's been asked by a superintendent to attend a weekend seminar on team building. In each case, you are assured that the program is research-based. If you want to know whether something is really research-based, how could you know? Well, research-based means that someone has done some formal scientific studies to evaluate whether or not the program, therapy, or gadget really does what it's purported to do. Such research will be published in specialty journals that are devoted to this sort of thing, so that's where you'll have to look for it. The simple act of trying to locate scientific studies of a practice may tell you that such studies haven't been done. That alone is useful, and happily, merely finding out whether studies have been done is now fairly easy using the internet. I'll have more to say about this in Chapter 7. But knowing whether or not relevant research exists is usually not enough. We saw this in the case of hyperbaric oxygen therapy for ASD. There is bona fide, high-quality evidence for inflammation in the brains of kids with ASD. There's bona fide, high-quality evidence that immunoglobulin can reduce inflammation. But to understand why the therapy is unlikely to work, you need a finer grain of detailed knowledge than most of us have. I'm dimly aware that there are multiple mechanisms by which brain tissue can become inflamed, but I really doubt I would have thought to wonder about that. I also would not have known that inflammation is not always a bad thing. It turns out that inflammation is sometimes a sign that the brain is trying to repair itself. I also probably would not have thought of the possibility that there's some other factor, call it X, which causes ASD and causes inflammation as a byproduct. Treating the inflammation would be like treating the fever you get with the flu. It doesn't make the virus go away because fever is a symptom, not a cause. Here's another example of the need for deep knowledge when trying to evaluate whether something is research-based. When I search secretin autism in Google Scholar, a database of scholarly research, I get 2010 hits. Secretin's a hormone that's important in digestion. The first article is titled, Lack of Benefit of a Single Dose of Synthetic Human Secretin in the Treatment of Autism and Pervasive Developmental Disorder. The second article is titled, Improved Social and Language Skill After Secretin Administration in Patients with Autism Spectrum Disorder. So it seems there's some controversy. Unfortunately, that's typical. Human behavior is not a simple cause and effect system. Behaviors, for example, repetitive behaviors in kids with ASD, usually have multiple causes. For example, stress may make symptoms worse. And the problems will vary across kids. So even if secretin has some positive effects, you may see them in some studies and not in others. More important, studies will vary in quality. There are better and worse ways of conducting scientific research, and a study doesn't have to be perfect to be published in a scientific journal. So what you really need to do is look at all the studies that have been done and try to see whether the ones that employ the best methodology are also the ones that show positive effects for secretin. That sounds hard enough to do, but the problem is still one step more difficult than that. It's not easy to know what constitutes a good study. Obviously, there are principles that guide research design and the use of statistics. Practice in thinking about those is certainly a help. But evaluating research quality also requires knowing the relevant scientific content. That's because the content affects your interpretation of whether or not the study was well done. Here's a simple example. Let's say you read a study of the effects of secretin on the behavior of kids with ASD. The study reports that secretin didn't help. You happen to notice that the study didn't test boys and girls separately. All the kids with ASD were considered one big group. Does that make it a bad study? Well, it depends. If previous research had shown that gender was an important variable in the way secretin works, that might mean this was a bad study. Or if there was reason to think that gender mattered in ASD, either in its symptomology or its treatment, then researchers probably should look at the effects of secretin separately on boys and girls. For any study, you can usually think of dozens of distinctions: right or left-handedness, time of day, other medications taken, diet, gene markers. Any of these might make a difference. And if we know that a factor has been important in prior work and the researcher ignored it, that's a valid criticism. Or suppose that the results of a study seem to directly conflict with the results of previous research. The author ought to at least discuss the possible reasons for the conflict, if not pursue the issue in a new study. Or suppose that prior research has shown that a statistical method one might typically use in a given situation doesn't work in this specialized case. Statistical techniques always rely on assumptions about the data. And let's say it's known that an important assumption doesn't hold for a particular reading test when kids under the age of 12 take it with a time limit. It's hard to be an intelligent reader of scientific articles if you're not already fairly well versed in the content. All the details I'm listing here are simply to emphasize that 1. Saying the research supports it ought to mean that the research was conducted in the right way, and 2. Knowing whether or not the research was conducted in the right way is no small matter. That's not to say that only professional researchers can assess scientific quality. I've met people who became expert on one topic or another and were sophisticated consumers of research. But it took them a long time to get that way. Research expertise is just like any other type of expertise. Developing it takes a lot of hard work and practice. Most people who have families, jobs, and other responsibilities cannot put in that sort of time. Is there a way to evaluate research that doesn't require becoming an expert? We undertake other tasks that, if done properly, would be terribly complex and time-consuming. The typical solution is not to invest the time and energy into doing a foolproof job. Rather, we find shortcuts that, although imperfect, get the job done. Consider the process of buying a car. It's a big purchase. You want to make sure that you get the most for your money, right? If you really want to optimize this decision, here's what you ought to do. First, rate the importance to you of all the features of an automobile from, say, 0 to 1. Hence, you might give reliability a 0.8, but heated seats just gets a 0.2. Second, rate every model of automobile for each of these features using a 1 to 10 scale. So the Porsche 911 gets a 10 for style, the Taurus gets a 3, and so forth. Third, for each car, multiply the ratings from step 2 and the importance values from step 1 and add the products. Now you have an overall value for each car that represents how much you like that car. Now that you know the desirability of each car, you need to factor in cost. In step 3, you'd research the maintenance costs for each car as well as depreciation and so forth. In step 4, you would visit each and every car dealership in your area and negotiate a price for each and every model that they carry. In step 5, you would repeat steps 1 through 4 for used cars. In step 6, you would combine all this information about desirability and cost, and you'd select the optimal car. Obviously, no one picks a car this way. It's too time-consuming. We are confronted by many tasks like this. There's a way to do the task that might be optimal, but we lack the time or knowledge to complete the task that way. So what do we do instead? We use an imperfect method called a heuristic. A heuristic is a shortcut. It's not the best way to do something, but it yields a solution that's usually pretty good, and it has the benefit of practicality. It's easy to calculate. When I last bought a car, my heuristic was, buy the first car you see that's fairly reliable, has 4 doors, a big trunk, room for 2 car seats in the back, and costs less than $18,000. I may not end up with the optimal car, but by putting up front the characteristics I know I care about a great deal, I'll probably end up satisfied, and I've made the problem manageable. Evaluating research is like buying a car. There's an optimal solution to the problem, which is to read and digest all of the relevant research, but most of us don't have the time to execute the optimal solution. What we need is a good shortcut. The shortcut solution. Our education system has multiple levels. The federal government attempts to influence the education policy of state governments. There are some 13,000 local school districts, each with its own administration, making decisions within the framework set by the states. School principals run their schools within the framework set by the district administration, and teachers run their classrooms within the framework set by the principals. If kids aren't learning enough in the classrooms, parents try to supplement what they learn. At every level of this system, people, motivated by politics, money, or altruism, try to influence what happens. And one of the most frequently used persuasive techniques is to figuratively don the white lab coat of science and intone, "The research says." I've said that a shortcut is the best way to judge whether or not a claim really is scientifically supported, but before I introduce the shortcut, I need to persuade you that it makes sense. The reasoning behind the shortcut I described for buying a car is pretty transparent. Cars have so many features that you can't possibly evaluate all of them, so instead you pay attention only to the most important. For the research shortcut to look logical, we need to get a few issues straight. First, we need to understand what sorts of things people find persuasive. I've already said that the people who try seemingly odd educational remedies, those who put their children in oxygen pressure tanks, or who figure that kids will learn by reading, memorizing what words look like, they're not crazy and they're not stupid. People were aware that the stakes were high as they made these decisions, and I'm more than ready to give them the benefit of the doubt that they made them thoughtfully. Nevertheless, people were persuaded that an educational intervention was scientifically backed when they should not have been so persuaded. What goes into a decision to believe or to disbelieve? In Chapter 1, I'll summarize some 50 years of research on this topic, and we'll see that the mind actually comes pre-equipped with shortcuts. Certain features of messages are treated as signals of truth. For example, long messages are deemed more believable than short ones. You may not be aware of the message features your mind focuses on, but salespeople, politicians, and savvy social manipulators are. It's time you knew about them too, and I'll describe them in Chapter 1. Second, we need to understand how laypeople, not scientists, think about scientific evidence. Surveys show that scientists are trusted more than people in almost any other profession, and people believe that scientific research is the most reliable type of evidence. Why? Why this implicit trust in science? This story starts in 16th century Europe, a time and place in which observing the world, cornerstone of science, was considered the least persuasive type of evidence. The most persuasive was authority. If the Bible, or ancient thinkers, especially Aristotle, said it, then it had to be right. The next 100 years saw a complete reversal of this attitude, with observation, especially controlled observation, as found in experiments, held in the highest esteem. The change in the weighting of evidence was due primarily to the wild success of the method in explaining the world and improving the human condition. Science came to influence, and usually to improve, virtually every aspect of human affairs. This means that the simple veneer of scientific evidence is an important persuader. This type of evidence is so powerful that in other fields, for example, medicine and engineering, we have strong institutions that monitor and control its use. It's illegal to say that a medicine has been scientifically tested if it has not. Education has no such constraints. Anyone can say that an educational nostrum is research-based, and that's why salespeople repeat the phrase like parrots. And that's why the research shortcut is needed. In Chapter 2, we'll look at how the situation reached this point. Third, if we're to have a research shortcut, we need to understand the path that we're cutting short. The shortcut is meant to provide easy passage to the goal we would reach if we took the long route. The goal is good science. Well, what does that look like? Interestingly enough, good science turns out to be as difficult to describe as pornography, but we cannot, as Supreme Court Justice Potter Stewart famously did, satisfy ourselves by saying, "I know it when I see it." In Chapter 3, I'll describe 7 principles that most experts would agree are scientific essentials. Chapter 3 will describe what good science looks like, but not how to use it. That's the subject of Chapter 4, which describes the distinction between basic sciences, for example, chemistry, biology, psychology, and disciplines like education that use findings from basic sciences. For example, if psychologists learn a new fact about how children think, is that new fact ready to be used in the classroom? I'll outline 2 ways that scientific findings can be used in education. The first method is rather painstaking and expensive, but it yields quite reliable knowledge. The second is inexpensive and is still painstaking when done well, but it's also easy to do sloppily. It produces knowledge of educational practice that ought to be considered tentative. As I'll show, the difficult, expensive method is a rarity in American education. The cheap, sloppy method is commonplace. Part of the shortcut is to recognize the difference. In Part 1, I argue that people are persuaded by poor arguments, that's Chapter 1, and especially by arguments that appear to be scientific, that's Chapter 2. Unfortunately, people are unable to distinguish between good and bad science, we'll cover that in Chapter 3, and they're usually unclear on how scientific findings can be brought to bear on education problems, which I'll talk about in Chapter 4. Part 2 offers the shortcut, composed of 4 processes to be applied to the candidate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.